Hey everybody, this is Sky. I'm the Yes Abroad FlexAbroad program manager, and I wanted to welcome you to a webinar we put together with some of our Yes Abroad alumni who were gracious enough to come talk about their experiences on program. They went to three different countries, and we always think that alumni make the best advertisements for Yes Abroad and Flex Abroad because they're the ones who lived these experiences when they speak and say this, you know, this is what happens and this is what it gave me. You know, it's for real. It's not just kind of the program talking about it. And as program staff, we always believe in like open and honest dialogue and communication with all of our participants and alumni. So thank you guys so much for joining. I wonder if I could just ask you to briefly introduce yourself to the people watching.
Hi
Boom.
everyone.
Oh, there you go. Ava, you go first. Yeah.
I'm Ava. I went to Indonesia program year 22, 23. I'm from Denver, Colorado, but I'm currently attending the University of New Mexico and I'm studying pharmaceutical science.
Okay, I'll go next. Hi, everybody. My name's Marina. I'm also alumni of the year 22-23. I studied abroad in Malaysia. I'm from Jupiter, Florida, and I'm currently at the University of Florida studying aerospace engineering.
Hi everyone, I'm Dina. I went to Jordan in the 21-22 year. I'm originally from Denver, Colorado, but right now I'm in Palo Alto, California, studying Earth Systems at Stanford.
Amazing. All right, guys. Thanks. Scientists, all of you. I want to note that, and I know that Marina noted that for me earlier. I remember talking to Marina and Ava last year at our pre-departure orientation. They joined us as alumni group leaders because of their successful stints on Yes Abroad. And I want to come back to this idea of success later because that's something that we talk about as staff a lot and we work with students and alumni on. But you guys are all all scientists. So I want to just put that out there because exchange is for everybody. I think this is a common misconception about study abroad that it's only for people who are interested in like history or international affairs, and those are the people who are going to be selected. But also, it is a year overseas is kind of only worth it to somebody studying those things, not engineering or earth sciences or pharmaceuticals. So I want to come back to that later. I didn't realize that you were studying that too, Dina. That's great. All right, guys, we have an application that's open right now. It's open until December 4th and for Yes Abroad and Flex Abroad, November 4th for Nisli Y. And I'm curious, you guys were in these participant or these applicant shoes 2 years ago and 3 years ago. I'm curious, how you heard about Yes Abroad or Flex Abroad, how you decided to start the application process, what your parents said about it, what were you even thinking? Did you even think you would get in? Did you hear about it the day before the application was due? What are these things? If anybody wouldn't mind sharing their story.
I can
Oh,
go. Oh, Marina. No, you can go, Ava, please.
Okay. So I actually applied to CBYX the year before that I applied to Yes, and I didn't get in. I was not an alternate. Like I wasn't even a semifinalist. Like I just did not get in. And I found that program because I was just sitting at home during COVID. Like I wanted something to do, and so I was looking at all the Department of State programs. And after I got that rejection, I was kind of thinking like maybe this isn't for me. Like I can just stay here and do something in college. But one of my close friends, she encouraged me. She was like, "No, like this is something you really wanted to do. And just because you didn't get in the first time, like that doesn't mean that you're not going to get in, or that doesn't mean it's not for you." So then I ended up finding the Yes program, and I felt like that was much more suited to me. And so I'm actually really glad I didn't get into CBYX because then I found Yes, I got in, and I was like really excited to go. My parents weren't super like thrilled about it. I think they were pretty happy when I didn't get into CBYX, not because they were like against it, but I'm really close with my family, and so they weren't super like eager about me going abroad for a year. My older sister, she stayed home for college, so we never really like branched out, but once they understood like how passionate I really was about it, then they were okay with it.
Great. All right. I love this idea of rejection and growth and paths. I mean, We reject a number of people from the program, and it doesn't necessarily mean they're not good. It means they're not ready. And I think that's a big part of, as probably you all saw on program, one of your previous alumni to Indonesia, but from many, many years ago, one time said at a pre-departure orientation, if you're not trying and failing a dozen times a day on Yes Abroad, then you're not doing this program right. So that's definitely something that builds character. And I think you're right. It helped you find your motivation too. Dina, what were you going to say?
Actually, a little bit similar to that, I was kind of just surfing the internet during COVID. I was really just looking for some abroad program to go on. And I think Yes Abroad was especially enticing. And I just found it on a random internet website somewhere. And I thought it was really cool because it's kind of the idea to me of when are you ever going to go abroad just on a full scholarship and have the opportunity to live with a host family and go to high school in a country and really experience what it's like. Not only being a kid in that country, but also just being like representative of your country too, and connecting with people on a deeper like level. So I thought that was really, really cool, and that was what encouraged me to apply. Of course, I found out about it 3 days before the application was due, so I was rushing to do that and get a rec letter. But thankfully, they extended the application after that, so that was good. But I would recommend taking your time with the application and really just being thoughtful and genuine about your answers because, sorry, that's what's going to make you stand out, I think. And it'll make you feel better too, knowing that you're honest and being genuine.
You
So
hit
that's
such
important.
an important point, you guys. The number of applications I read where it's like somebody has read a book on how to write the most captivating college essay really like is not going to help you in this. So one time last year a Flex Abroad participant was doing a takeover and she mentioned working for her app on her application for 15 hours and I was like, "Oh my gosh, why?" Like, no, it's truly about being yourself. I can tell you if you're not yourself in your application and you're somebody else, or you promote values you don't have or skills that you don't yet have, it'll come out eventually when you're on program, right? Like this is not like getting accepted is sort of just the beginning of the challenge that comes with the program. But yes, I think being yourself, being honest, answering the questions just as they are. And honestly, maybe even only having 3 days gave you less time to like overthink it.
For sure. And the funny thing was, I submitted it the day that it was announced that it would be extended. So it did work out really well. But I think it was nice because, like you said, I didn't have time to overthink it. I didn't have time to kind of go through all the options of how to do everything in my head. So my parents read over it with me and then we just submitted it. And I kind of accepted. I said, listen, I did it so last minute. If I don't get in, it's not the end of the world. And so I went with an expectation of maybe not getting in. And then my imagination thought, hey, if I do get in, wouldn't it be really cool? So I think just going in without expectations was really helpful too. So definitely keep an open mind with
Good.
application.
Yeah. What about you, Marina?
Yeah.
Same story.
So I guess pretty similar. I knew I always wanted to study abroad from a young age, but of course, like my parents weren't really able to fund that for me. So one day, I think it was also COVID, probably around the same time Ava was looking. I saw, I think it was a Reddit or Instagram post about something, something studying abroad for free with the government. And I looked into it and I found this amazing program. So I applied to Yes Abroad along with NSLIY, which is another great program. And it was the one, it was something that I was just super passionate about. And when I was writing my essays, I was like, even if it's embarrassing, let me let them know about my little quirks or what really makes me super passionate about it. And ultimately, I was accepted both, like, in, of course, I was accepted into Yes, and then I was also accepted into NSLIY. I ended up choosing Yes just because I felt I wasn't, I wanted something a bit longer and not so language focused. And I felt that just definitely aligned so more with me. And then in terms of like my parents and everything, my mom was definitely on board because, first of all, it's programmed with the government. And it has a really great long reputation. And there's so many people behind the scenes who's working to help out. So that was sort of my application process. Yeah.
Amazing. In terms of like inspiration, Dina, you said something that it was something that was so interesting and like a plus for you. that sometimes when I am talking to parents or students, especially kids who are calling about Nestle Y, right? Which, for background, maybe some of you watching are familiar with the National Security Language Initiative for Youth, which is a language immersion program. So you're with other American students in a classroom for, I think, 3 to 4 hours a day, studying the language intensively, but you're also living with a host family and having these kind of cultural activities as well. And it differs from Yes Abroad and Flex Abroad in that, Dina, you said, you get to go to high school in another country. How cool is that? And I think sometimes American young people think, well, this is like a distraction from my goal of like studying this language, right? And this for you is a benefit. I guess I want to ask you to expand upon that. Like, what for you was exciting about the idea of going to school in another country and living with a host family?
I think it was very striking on the first day because I wasn't originally supposed to go to Jordan. I was supposed to go to the Philippines and then was reassigned because of COVID. So coming to Jordan, I knew nothing about Arabic. I knew maybe the basic alphabet. And so I came and it was like striking on the first day because my host mom only spoke Arabic. So right off the bat, I was kind of thrown into the deep end and had to learn. And then going to school was also a little scary because all of the kids at school had already known each other all of their lives, and I was just coming in and kind of going out as an exchange student. But I think the most amazing part about going to school is that you really experience life through the lens of somebody that's grown up in the country that you're in, because you get to see how these people have grown up and what their value sets are, having grown up in that system. And then seeing just the way that the education system works and how it differs from the US is super interesting. So I really do think that there's a lot of value in actually attending school because you make connections with people in your classes and with your teachers and with the staff and with the people on the bus that drive the bus and take care of the bus. So I think going to school really opens a lot of doors for you. So you shouldn't see it as like a negative part of the program. I think it really is a positive part. And it opens up another like secondary community to you outside of your host family and just the general community you would be in if you were just studying the language.
It's like the, like you said, you meet the all the people who take care of the bus and the cafeteria ladies, right? And like the your friend's parents. And I think what jumped in my brain first was kind of like the center of a ever expanding web of like or of paths of roads where you could it's like an infinite number of connections and opportunities that are kind of at your disposal if you build these connections. Guys, Dina, you said it provides you another lens, which is something we talk about pre-program, and we know the value working in the international education and international affairs sector, the value of multiple perspectives. I guess, why do you all think, why is that a value? Why is that something that people, anyone, even studying, pharmaceuticals or engineering or whatever, why should people seek to, if gain multiple perspectives from different cultural standpoints, if that's not something that they're going to be, if diplomacy is not something they're going to be working in.
Yeah, I feel like I can maybe talk about this a little bit. So, definitely, at least within STEM. So, basically, like as Americans, like we all grow up, of course, we're not all the same, but we all grow up with very similar shared experiences. And the way that we grow up in America shapes our outlook on life, and of course, then our decisions, right? And so, I do see in my engineering classes, there might be some people that they might not have an external perspective to look back on, or they might think that their decisions won't affect other people. But for example, if you're making such big decisions, like if you're in pharmaceuticals or you're engineering, and of course, international relations and everything, your decisions are very impactful. They're going to impact everybody. So you have to be able to look at it through different lenses and see, okay, how is this not just going to impact me, but how is this going to impact other people? And that kind of different perspective also helps you in really making the right decision. So for example, if I didn't go abroad, I would keep thinking of things through a Floridian sort of perspective, right? So this can even extend just to regular traveling, right? But if I didn't think of like how people abroad in different countries would be affected by this, then my what I do would only affect it would affect certain groups differently. So that's just one reason why going abroad and having those different perspectives is, I think, really important.
We talked about that this summer, I think, Ava, did we were talking about like water projects, right? Like if you're coming in as an American to a foreign country to like engineer some major project, the idea that you just have this one perspective on the value of it or the disruption of it. I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah, I think that when I came back from my program, I was like really, I don't know, it was a very strange time for me because I didn't realize how many Americans have like the America is the center of the world mindset. And I think I had a little bit of that and I didn't even realize because I've always been like an open-minded person. I've always wanted to learn about the world. Like I'm really good at geography. I don't feel like I really fit that stereotype, but over my program year, I didn't even realize the change was taking place. But when I came back, I just had such a different view on the world. I feel like a lot of people here, like just in America, think that this is the world, like not even intentionally. But that is so interesting that now if you're going abroad for those types of like outreach projects and stuff, I think it is really important to be able to view the world as like not just this.
Do you guys think this sets you apart from your peers when you, I mean, you're all, I guess, what, sophomores in college, juniors in college, something? What does this set you apart from the people that you work with in some way? Does it make you feel, I mean, certainly as soon as participants come home, I always say, get ready to be the most mature person like in any room for the next like 5, 6, 7 years until your peers kind of catch up with you. Do you find this to be true? Is it challenging? Like, do you think it's beneficial?
Definitely challenging, I think. I'll just say it shortly so someone else can jump on. But yeah, when I first came back, and I think Isaac and a couple of other people were also talking about this issue. It's not that you look down on your peers, but you sort of feel like, wow, they haven't gone abroad. They haven't been challenged in this way, really, ever. They haven't been forced to look at the world in a completely different lens. And that's difficult, of course, but you also have to realize, like, of course, not everybody's going to go abroad. And, you know, it's just about, it's working with different people, you know, working with different perspectives, I guess.
Right, it goes even beyond, I think, on the smaller level, this idea of working with people from different backgrounds or different perspectives is just like incredibly useful collaborating with people, right? Like, not everybody thinks the same. Not everybody has the same background in the United States. And I think those are really big. You know, we talk about, I was mentioning to you guys, we talk about soft skills a lot and in this world. In managing this program over the past 10 years, I've seen just how incredibly challenging and hard soft skills are. They're the hardest skills to obtain. You can't just study for them. You can't make flashcards. You have to do it by, like you said, Marina, by being challenged. What do you think? Was this program harder than you thought it would be when you first applied? What were the challenges that really ended up hitting you, and were you prepared for them?
I think for me, it definitely was like way more challenging than I thought. During all like the webinars and orientations and everything, I was told like it's not a vacation. You're there like doing hard work. And I mean, I believed it. Like I guess I
You
just
didn't
didn't
think
really
we were
realize what
lying,
that
right?
meant.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I guess like when you're going abroad, you have to know that you're dealing with all the challenges you would have in your regular life while in America, but then
Yes.
you also have like more on top of that, that's related to life abroad. So I feel like they say about exchangers that it's like a life in a year. And I do feel that's like you're forced in 1 year to go through all the experiences that most people have in like 10 years if they
Like, give
stay
me
in one
some
place.
examples. Like, what do you think? What kind of additional, right? You know, you have your standard friend challenges or miscommunications, or, you know, you're thinking about your future. Those are th things you would happen either place. But what are the additional challenges that hit you when you're overseas that you don't anticipate?
Yeah, so I would say that one of the most like challenging times of my year abroad was in it was in like probably the first couple months. So then I was doing my college apps, like I was doing everything I would be in senior year in America, but I was also dealing with a lot of culture shocks. Specifically at my school, I was having some issues with a girl in my class. She was like a disabled girl, but they have a lot of like different views around that in Indonesia. And so she was being treated in a way that I wasn't really used to, and I was having a lot of trouble like figuring out how to go about doing that and figuring out like who to go to with these questions because I didn't really have like a strong community, you really have to build it from scratch. And so you have all of that, like, kind of on top of dealing with your regular challenges.
Yeah, figuring out the figuring out how to navigate relationships and like you said, community. And in Indonesia in particular, I know the communication style is very different. There's a huge weight put on like def like not only direct versus indirect communication, but also if somebody's older than you and being like deferential, and even just the concept of values of like the individual's kind of value and what I want to do versus you're part of a community and the community is valued kind of higher than sometimes what the community wants, culturally speaking, is valued higher than kind of what Ava wants, right? And you have to learn how to navigate, like you said, while still trying to figure out what's right, what's, you know, which way's up, which way's down.
Right. Yeah. You're not really meant to challenge things in that community. And so that's where kind of the issue came with me is that I didn't know where that line was. And so you kind of have to figure that out, definitely.
What about you, Dina? Did you, what were the challenges that you found? Was the program more challenging than you anticipated? What were those challenges? Did you feel prepared to meet them?
I felt like the program was a lot more challenging than I initially expected it to be. I think part of it was because I was really young. I was 15 going into the program. I was going into my sophomore year of high school. So I was barely in high school and, freshman year was COVID year. So I hadn't really experienced anything yet. So I was super excited, I think, going into it. And I wasn't really thinking about challenges in particular. I thought, okay, language barrier, learn the language. And I think I underestimated how challenging that would actually be in reality, especially with my host mom not being able to communicate with her for the first few months at least was really, really challenging. And I remember not dreading coming home, but almost being like, oh no, okay, I really gotta focus. I have to figure out how do I express what I need to her and how do I understand what she needs from me. And luckily my host sister spoke English, so that was really good. But it was challenging initially, and I remember feeling very frustrated because I really wanted to connect with her and I really wanted to understand her, I think, in a way that at that time just wasn't available because of the language barrier. So I think that was very challenging. And it was something that I think the program did prepare us for. Like, we did have preparation regarding host family situations and what it'll look like language-wise and culture-wise. So I did feel prepared in that sense, but I think it's different when you experience it in reality, and it just hits a little bit different. And I think another thing was just like the way that the community functions in Jordan. I feel like people are very spontaneous. And so somebody will call you at 8 p.m. and say, hey, we're going to the supermarket right now. Put on your shoes, we're going. And you'll be in the middle of a chemistry assignment or something. And at first it was a lot of fun, but I think I had to learn how to pace myself and say, listen, I need to stay in and finish this. So it was like challenges that I didn't expect. So I think part of the program is just while we are prepared very well, I think, for cultural differences and kind of keeping our minds open and looking through different lenses, there will definitely be challenges that we can't predict
Can't
that will
predict them.
arise.
Yeah. I've noticed that over the past, oh, I don't know, 10 years more. So when I first started working on this program in 2012, you know, I mean, I had worked in the countries that I implemented it in, Bosnia and then Macedonia, for a long time with our inbound YES students, so our high school kids coming from that region. And I lived in that region as a Peace Corps volunteer. And so I had a good sense of that. But I didn't have enough. I didn't know exactly what somebody's day-to-day schedule would look like. I didn't know exactly what, you know, and so over time, over those next few years, so I wasn't able to give hard details to all of our participants. And after 3, 4, 5 years, I was like, oh, this is great. I have so many more details. I can just give these participants more information. More information is better. And it totally started backfiring because I started hearing from participants, you didn't tell us this. You didn't tell us. And I was like, well, how am I supposed to know? You know, things change. And I realized, oh, I was causing the problem. I was, by giving as much information as I could and giving all these details, I was subconsciously making them feel like they could prepare to know what was about to happen. And in reality, the best thing that I can do is just tell people you'll figure it out. We'll help you figure it out. And so our pre-departure orientations were very, very vocal now. You guys are the be beneficiaries of that. Of us saying, in fact, I think I literally said, this isn't like it is on on Zoom. You can't just we can't just change our background screen, right? And have it be like we're living our normal lives, but with a different background or like a different view out the window. There's truly thing we could never in a million years predict and prepare you for the infinite possibilities and challenges that would arise. The best thing we can do is prepare you to have the correct mindset. Which I think you all, in listening to you talk, those are all the things that you were able to utilize, and you had that maturity to be prepared for that, right? To be prepared to think, oh, maybe I need to question what's right. Maybe I need to ask more questions rather than telling people exactly what needs to happen. In terms of skills, so we talked a little bit about, you guys have all talked about having an open mind. You guys have all talked about, you haven't said it out loud, but the things that you've talked about to me represent, I think, being flexible. Like Dina talking about like how do you communicate with your mom? And I guess for the record, at some point you keep saying first few months, you at some point did learn to communicate with your host mom. And I'm guessing it's because she didn't become suddenly fluent in English, right? You learned Arabic.
I did. So I think that was one thing that really helped about having a host family that didn't speak English was that at least with her, I was forced to practice Arabic. And so she would teach me words. And then I kind of went out of my way to take extra lessons outside of school. And that really, really helped a lot. And then like every taxi, every Uber, I would practice with the driver and then
Absolutely.
come home and practice with her. So by the end, we
Yes.
like understood each other.
I guess I'm curious. So you had to kind of figure out how to put yourself out there, right? I think that's a big part of study abroad is being brave and introducing yourself to people. What are some other skills that you feel like you learned on program? Besides seeing things through a different lens, but what are some more like soft skills that are actually not soft, not easy at all, that you guys find that you use day to day? What has been the biggest, beneficial
Right.
takeaways?
I'll keep it brief, but essentially, for example, in Malaysia, the sense of humor is very different over there and the style of communication. And if I'm looking, for example, when I first went over there, if I was looking at it through strictly an American lens, I could very easily get offended quite easily. But I was able to sort of mentally just be like, the sense of humor is different, first of all. They don't mean it in a way of malice, for example. And that's that sort of thinking of like take everything with like treat people with grace, give people like the benefit of the doubt. That's something that's really helped me in my day-to-day because there's been times where I'm really frustrated at school or with my part-time job and I'm like, these people are really out to get me. But then I'm like, wait, no, it might not be that. They might have a bad day or I might just not be understanding it properly. And of course, definitely draw the line when you feel something's going too far. But just being able to like benefit of the doubt and treating things with grace, that's something that really helped me that I learned from my exchange here.
That's great. What about you, Ava?
I think for me it was problem solving, and I know that's like basic answer, but it's definitely something I use every day. And I think it's definitely a skill you can develop wherever you are. But my year abroad, it really taught me how to solve things in different ways and like use critical thinking and like really approach a situation head on. And that's definitely, I mean, I'm what, 2 years out of the program, and I think it's definitely still something I use every single day of my life.
What about you, Dina? What are some skills that you walked away with that you use today?
I think the main one, and this was actually repeated to me a couple of weeks ago when I came to Stanford, the president told us this at the convocation, and it was be curious, not judgmental. And I think those are really, really good words of advice. And I think that's kind of what I came back with from Jordan was just being curious about everything, being curious about, okay, why does this happen? Why does somebody act like this? Why is this cultural practice done in this specific way? And I think just curiosity is really, really what you come back with because now you've seen a whole different world, basically. It's completely different than what you've ever seen before. And the life that you've lived is not something you're probably very familiar with. Just like the types of interactions you're going to have on the street, the types of streets you're going to walk on, the types of places you're going to go, and the people that you see is very different. So I think going there with your mind very curious versus being very judgmental definitely helps a lot. And I think that's helped me become more empathetic also and more understanding towards other people because now my roommate actually, she's from Mongolia and we have like been trying to connect and everything. And so I think going abroad really helped me because now I try and see things from her perspective. Like what was life like in Mongolia? How does she feel being here all alone in a country that she's never been to before? And so I think being abroad really helps you foster that empathy and that understanding of people cross-culturally. And especially when people don't speak, English as well as you do, sometimes we just label them off as like, okay, they don't know anything. But once you go abroad and you experience that more often, you see like, wow, these people are people. They're really smart in their own way. And just because they can't communicate in the same language as you doesn't make them any dumber or any less smart than you are. So I think it really, really fosters that soft skill of just being more understanding and being kinder almost to other people. So I think that's really important. And sometimes we don't even see that, like, and you would think it would be more prevalent, but going abroad really, really helped with that.
I think also, I mean, even what made me think is right. Maybe we're talking about giving people the benefit of the doubt and being kind and understanding and not writing people off because they don't speak as well as we do. But you were all in places where you were the ones who didn't speak as well, where you were the ones that everyone was like, "Oh, who is this American girl who doesn't know anything?" Right? And I think that idea, that situation really makes you humble. And certainly that was my experience too. And when you're humble, you also don't take things for granted. I think especially as all of you had to, I mean, you all had host families and you had schools and you had coordinators and liaisons who could help you out. But like Ava said, you really had to do a lot of stuff on your own. And I think there's a great value in understanding just how much goes into keeping your life running day to day. We had an alum who was in Bulgaria one time referred to doing this program as like a boot camp for adult life, and making sure that you had the skills to function each day. And for me, I think it's certainly I came home from living overseas confident because I was so scared. I mean, when I was your age, I was so scared to go off to college and I was an au pair in France for 6 weeks. And I came back from that being like, oh, yeah, I got this. I can do college, right? And then I was so scared to leave college and go off and be an adult in the world. What am I going to do? How am I going to take care of myself? Do I have the abilities to actually be responsible for myself and have a job and have an apartment and all these things? And I came back from living overseas and thinking, of course, I can do. If I did this in a foreign country, right? If I made friends, if I could do my homework, if I could do all these things, I can do this in America too. And I think that confidence really gives you just peace of mind, and I don't know, it makes you feel better about living your life, I guess, day to day. As my perspective, at least. I don't know. Okay, I think we're about out of time, and I'm looking at all my notes to see if we covered what it is I wanted to cover, and I think we did. Do you guys have anything else you want to add? I mean, we've talked a lot about why people should apply for this program, but I think sometimes one thing we didn't talk about is how this participation in this program can be like a detour from your path of success, right? That many young people feel very nervous about being successful and getting into the right college. Getting into college, not being left behind, and looking at you, it looks like at least two of you are living in a dorm. So that means you successfully did obtain entry into a reputable university. Did this program take you off your path? I mean, we talked about you all doing STEM. Was this a detour?
So for me personally, it was not a detour at all. So I guess this sort of has to do a bit with the application process as well and like thinking ahead. So for me, I applied in my junior year and then I was accepted and I was like, wait a minute, am I going to come back to high school? I'm going to do this. So what I did was I took a lot of online classes. I took a whole lot of extra, I think it was 10 classes in my last semester so I could graduate early. So technically I graduated early and did it as a gap year. And then I applied to colleges while I was overseas, right? And I think throughout the entire college application process, that was sort of my spike. And not to get like too into like the application process, but I can say that this path, not only did it helped me get into basically the colleges that I really wanted to. All the interviewers were incredibly impressed with the fact that I was up at 3 a.m. talking to them, but also just everything that I learned while on program, being able to bring it back, I feel like it set me leagues above my peers, definitely.
Wow.
Yeah, I think that every year we have a lot of people that are like concerned about missing prom and graduation and that kind of stuff. I did go my senior year and I missed all of that kind of stuff, prom, graduate. I missed my own graduation. So, but I will say that when you're abroad, like I wasn't even thinking about it. My life was just so different and I was doing all these things that seemed so much bigger to me that I like the day of prom, my friends were there, they were all posting pictures. I was like, great. I'm glad you're having fun. I don't wish I was there. Like, it really wasn't a problem for me while I was gone.
Good. Dina, what about you?
I totally agree. I think if you are very much living in the present in whatever country you're hosted in, you will be happy. And, there will be challenges. You're not going to be happy every moment of it. But, I think when you're living in the present and you're appreciating everything around you and you realize kind of this almost limited time that you have, it becomes all the more beautiful and really more exciting in that sense. So don't feel like you're missing out. And school-wise, I can attest to this. I was very worried about my credits and about how that would transfer over. So really make sure to figure it out with your school in the US first, because ultimately they're going to be the ones deciding whether or not to accept your credit. So I would say talk to your registrar's office, talk to the records office, and see what their policy is. Sometimes they don't have a set policy, so you can kind of help them set that policy. And then when you come back, you can figure it out with them. I still graduated as valedictorian with my credits from Jordan. So I promise it'll work out, guys. It's okay. Just make sure to talk to people, like take the initiative yourself to talk to people and build that connection with them so that they trust that you're bringing back good scores and good credits. So definitely don't worry too much about the credits. Really just enjoy the time that you have there, and it will help on. Just it'll help shape you into somebody that colleges will view as a well-rounded individual, and I promise.
What a great perspective, because I was just thinking, like, I want people to know that this program adds value to what people are trying to achieve without also saying you should do this program just to get into college. No, but the way you said it is perfect. This program will add value to you and m shape you into the person that a college wants to have, because like you said, like you're Dean said, I think it was you said, be curious, not judgmental, right? Live in the moment. You're happiest when you live in the moment. I say this all the time when people are applying and they ask about credits. I say, manifest this. Talk about, I live this in my life all the time. I talk about all the things I'm interested in and things come to me, right? Because people hear I'm interested and they want to connect me with those things. And I say this with school. Tell everybody at your high school that you're interested in this. A teacher may share with you their experience overseas that's helpful for you. You know, may give you a different perspective on some of the host countries that are available and maybe be your advocate with the administration, right? So talk about it. Like you said, be proactive. Guys, thank you so much for joining me today. I really appreciate it. And two of these ladies, we'll see them. I just saying tomorrow, their area representatives as alumni, and putting together projects for the future. Again, thank you so much. Have a great rest of your week, and we'll see you.
Thank you so much, Sky.
Thank you
Thank you,
so
guys.
much.
Thank you.